It says my microphone is not working.
Can you hear us, Miss Menino?
Denise, can you hear me? Denise, can you hear us?
I don't think my microphone's working.
We can hear you when you speak into your mic.
Mark?
Yes.
Tom was having trouble logging in. Tom Funchin, are you able to send him another link?
Yes, I can.
Thank you.
He should be receiving it now, Ashley.
Thanks, Mark.
Mark, I'm gonna guess that Denise is saying that her speaker isn't working. Would you mind trying to call her and see if you could talk her through that part?
Yeah, I've got her number here.
Hey, everybody.
Hello.
Can't hear anybody.
Can you
hear me? I can't hear.
You cannot now still? Oh, no.
Yeah, Mark's going to give her a call.
Can you hear me? I'm unmuted.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, good.
We have a quorum. How many folks are on? See, Denise, Karen, myself. So we need to wait for a few more folks to show up.
Hello?
I can hear you.
Yes.
Can you hear?
Yes.
Hello, hello.
All right. I hope that that works. I can't. Dory, can you say something if you hear me?
Hear me?
Nope, I can't hear.
Can't hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Mm-hmm. I can. Yeah. Yes. Same as system built-in input, same as built-in output. So which one am I supposed to select? Oh, built-in input. I'm gonna mute myself. And under select, that's under select a microphone. It says built in input, and then select a speaker. It says built in output.
Yeah. So, Denise, can you hear me?
No, I don't think
she
can.
Can you ask her so we can go ahead and get started while you guys are trying to work that out?
Sure.
I am muted right now.
No, we can hear you.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, Dory. Uh-huh.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right, looks like we've got enough folks for a quorum. So I will call to order this meeting of the Sustainability Committee of the City of Tarpon Springs of Florida this Thursday, August 20th, 2020 at 6 p.m. Can I get a roll call, please?
Chairperson Larson?
Present.
Vice Chairperson Robinson?
Here.
Mr. Mandalu?
Here.
Ms. Menino?
She's here. Yeah, yeah.
Mrs. Gallagher?
Having technical issues.
Here.
Ms. Sanger?
Here.
All right. Well, welcome back, everyone. It's been an eventful month. Hope you're all doing well. And I would like to take our first item on the agenda, which is the approval of the minutes. Did everybody have a chance to look over it? Are there any questions or concerns? Or I guess I'll pause there and see if anybody has any comments. Seeing, hearing none, I would like a motion to approve those minutes, please.
Motion to approve. Okay, I'll be second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye?
Aye.
All right. Next item on the agenda is a presentation from our Public Works Director, Tom Funchen. So I would like to hand it over to him. And thank you very much for being with us tonight. Appreciate you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm not sure how you can hear me all right. No problem. Everyone can hear me? Okay. I'm having a little bit of thunderstorm over by my house here. So I'm kind of out my patio area. So I apologize if we have some disruptions. Okay, I'm going to bring up my screen here. Let's see now. Can everyone see that? We're good. Okay, cool. Anyone hear me?
Yes, sir, right. We can.
This is like a doctor's test. You realize that, right? Okay, I appreciate everyone inviting me here for this meeting. Yeah, I'm Tom Funchen, Public Works Director. Just give me a second. I am not as talented as Mr. Smith when it comes to this stuff over here, so just bear with me. Okay.
Tom, you want to click on that screen in the bottom corner to get presentation mode going? You see that little screen down there?
Hold on a second.
Yeah. There's a little like slide projection screen down on the red bar near the right corner.
I'm on my projection. Give me a second here, sir.
Yeah, it'll just make the slides bigger on the screen for everybody.
Oh, I mean, I know what you want. Hold on, just give me a second here.
Yeah.
Get this back again. All my junk I got on here. Where's my computer? It's fighting me a little bit right now.
It looks also like in the top left, there's like a little slide.
Is that better?
There we go.
I apologize.
All right.
Again, I'm not as talented as Mr. Smith is on this stuff, so bear with me. So, okay, this is a public works presentation regarding sustainability here in the city of Tarpon Springs. And I'll give you a quick little overview of some of the things we've done in the past, and then we can discuss where we're going in the future as we go along, probably at the end of the presentation. Some of the challenges I have here with my sustainability, especially when it comes to facilities, is the challenges of not only the buildings that we operate, is actually the type of buildings and the operations itself. We have historic buildings, which not only do you want to make those improvements, but you have to take that in consideration. Multi-use buildings, much like City Hall, which has different needs and different times of the day. 24-hour operations, like the public safety building with, of course, our police and fire department, and then minimally used buildings, much like the cultural center, where we don't get many hours operation over here. And that, again, they all bring different types of challenges, but we're getting through them. One of the things that facilities maintenance has done over time over here is that we've started about 4 years ago, we're actually in our fifth year, with an energy contracting contract with a company called Amerisco. We're actually reducing our energy uses and we're also reducing our costs. This has to do with HVAC, of course, lighting, plumbing, a number of different things over here. Over the last year, up to this year, actually this year's last savings, I get a report every March. Not only have we reduced our usage, we've actually saved some money, and the savings are about $121,000 over this past year, which is pretty good. Other things we've done, of course, is variable speed pumps. We've done some work with them over at the treatment plant, because as you know, we're moving material all the time, and the fact that you use a different type of pumps reduces the energy loads. Of course, it saves us money in the long run. We're going to continue, as we've been going for the last few years, on some of the building envelope improvements. That's the entire buildings in most cases, much like you see in the City Hall a few years back. Cultural Center was just done. We actually did some work in-house a couple of years ago at the Cultural Center. Head to Heritage Building, we did some interior work, some insulation work. And then somewhere in the near future, hopefully we can expand on solar panels and get us hopefully somewhat off the grid, or at least lessen our dependency on the grid. Mm-hmm. The other real important things that people think about, don't think about sustainability, is stormwater. We've done a lot of work in stormwater over the last couple of years, a couple of huge projects that really made some differences. We're trying to, of course, is the concern is the stormwater runoff or the overflows in the portions of areas where it reaches the ground that actually end up being directly out to our outfalls. We've done a lot of new work where we've minimalized that or almost eliminated in some areas when it comes to trenching, special ponds, a lot of look at impervious areas, and probably trying to get reduce those impacts. So a lot of new piping. We do have some issues with some of the piping. We're doing some upgrades to the city's existing system, plus, of course, in the future. Hopefully stormwater lining where we make these pipes. We don't have so much infiltration or exfiltration what we had in the past. Another part of the Public Works Department is roads and streets, which kind of works together with the stormwater department. And sustainability, of course, has to do with lifestyle too. And we're very proactive on our sidewalk program. We've increased our response when we do have issues, missing sidewalks, repairing the defective sidewalks. Of course, installing new sidewalks when none exist currently. Of course, that also has to do with the safe transport to school, those areas. We spend a lot of time paying attention to the kids walking, and hopefully encourage them to walk and ride their bikes to school. ADA is also another one, again, for those who are handicapped, their access around the city. That is all part of every project we do, whether it's we're doing new sidewalks or doing paving. ADA is a large part of our focus. And of course, we're also updating existing ADAs. Many ADAs that were put in back in the 90s and early 2000s have come out of compliance. So as we can and where we can, we are repairing those, replacing those, and upgrading those. Roads. I know a lot of people think about roads and flooding, and our maintenance is very important to those roadways too. Of course, just managing the pavement itself, the existing pavement, just by simple repairs, potholes, utility repairs, that makes a huge difference in just the livability of the roads, the drivability, and of course that's to reduce braking, reduce speeds hopefully, so that helps with everyone all the way around. We're doing a lot of street resurfacing. As you see, we have a little extra money come up next year's resurfacing. That's a little different than reconstruction. That's just putting a new surface on some existing roads. That does a couple of things. One is we look deeply into that and make sure that these roads do also have the proper drainage on it. Just simple resurfacing can make a difference in flooding areas. If you can raise the surface up a couple of few inches, it can really make a big difference. I can talk about a project that we've done with the county a couple of years ago. Street reconstruction is a big focus. We do have a couple of streets we just finished up. Again, a lot of it's drivability, traffic, walkability, even new roads. People have tendency to bicycle onto them, which we share our roads here, and it becomes much more prudent to have smooth, clean, usable roads so everyone can use it, not only the vehicles, but also bicycles and others. We are very aggressive on our sweeping program. We have a couple of sweepers in the city. They're out almost every single day. We record everything. Of course, it has to do with our MPDS permits over here. We are very aggressive on that. Of course, clean streets means clean stormwater, and clean stormwater means cleaner waters all the way around. So it affects all of us. some of the new roads we're working on, or the future, of course, is, like I said before, either inclusion of bike paths or a share ride program. I think Beers Boulevard is going to be a combination of a roadway and also a shared surface for bicycles. Again, and most of our future considerations go with not only with the servicing, of course, was with the stormwater element of all our roads, with rain gardens and bio swales, stuff that keeps everything within sight, and we're not discharging out to any open waters where we can. Of course, the big part of this is a tree canopy around the city. That's important too. That's two good things. One, of course, it's great for the environment. It also protects your roads, believe it or not. You keep that heavy Florida sun off those roadways. It actually helps extend the life of the roadway, so you don't get as much deterioration of those roadways. So it works kind of for everybody. Plus, you put the canopies over sidewalks too, and of course, it's much more comfortable to walk in the shade in the middle of August than it is in the sun. And again, as one of the other things we've been starting to work on too is some semi-pervious solutions, pervious pavement. As you know, that's coming along. I don't know if anyone's ever seen it, and I can't show you, I don't have a photo of it, but I can tell you one of the roadways that actually has it, it's been a real big success. And hopefully we're gonna take more of that into the city. Vehicle maintenance. We're on roads, we're on streets. Of course, you got vehicles. A number of years ago, we brought in a no idle policy. It's probably been now about 8-9 years now. So we've been a little bit ahead of the game on no idle policy. That's actually, of course, saves fuel, saves wear and tear on the vehicles, saves maintenance. Because a lot of our vehicles are not judged by the many hours around the vehicle and also the condition, but also the hours on the equipment. That's a big thing. We've actually had issues with someone of our suppliers, I think it was Ford, was actually charged us by the hour on our warranties instead of on the miles. And we come to find out that for every hour of vehicle idles, it's actually 24 miles added to the odometer. Which a lot of people don't understand that, but it can make a difference in your warranty. And most of our manufacturers are going to start going to those that have internal combustion engines. One of the other things we've done in the fleet, which is really, really, really important, is everyone I have working in the fleet department, is five of them, are all ASC certified. We don't have the old parts replacers. We're not just replacing parts, which used to be the thing. These are very certified, all top of the line, and we certify and we repair everything from fire trucks to wheelbarrows. You name it, we got it, and everyone's certified. One of the other things we're starting to add more right now, we have a portable one, is GPS. GPS is great, but GPS also helps in just managing our fleet. And we're starting to do some more training with our a lot of people working public works by using GPS, showing the routes they're taking and trying to lessen the miles and time they're putting on their vehicles. Again, I mean, it's made a big difference. Shop upgrades, of course, like we've done in other buildings, with lighting, reusable shop rags, recycling all our materials. We're pretty up on that, and we stay right on top of it. A couple of other things we're doing too is the purchase of electric and hybrid vehicles. We're slowly reducing our dependency on this stuff. Actually, last year we reduced our overall fuel consumption by 3%, and it's kind of, we're trying to get somewhere between 2-3% every year to reduce it. I'm sure it's going to flatline somewhere eventually, but hopefully not. Maybe we can get down to almost zero in not too distant future. Parks and parkways. This is another one. This is my parks department that does all the fields and the right-of-ways. One of the things we've implemented about a year and a half ago was more technology in our irrigation systems, where we actually just use a cell phone. So these cell phone over here, a couple of cell phones that actually control the irrigation systems. Tonight's a perfect example. If it's raining and I have someone out there, we just turn the system off instead of relying on the timer. It's going to reduce our water consumption, hopefully by 10 or 15% in the next couple of years. That's what we're looking for. Mm-hmm. We're much more aggressive on our planting. We get more native and regionally appropriate type of species. And of course, we work very hard on preserving the tree canopy. That's important for everybody, especially the health of these trees. We've increased the trimming, not the amount of trimming, but a little more of a better schedule on our trimming. So hopefully that will keep our canopy pretty healthy. And where we do have to take something down, we immediately replace. So nothing comes down without being replaced. We've also done quite a bit of job in knocking back on the use of our Roundup. Roundup, as much as it seems like, is a great tool, and it works very well. Of course, you know the environmental impacts of Roundup. So we've actually reduced a bit by about 30-40% right now. We're actually adding a little extra labor by pulling weeds, and we're trying to test on more products a little more environmentally friendly. And we're hoping somewhere along the road we can even improve on that. One of the other things we've done, I guess I have a new supervisor in the Parks Department, is how we even mow, as simple as mowing the grass, leaving the clippings in the soils themselves over here, mowing a hair higher, as you see, mowing at 3 inches tall, keeps the moisture, keeps the grass a little bit greener, keeps it a little more uniform, and directional mowing. We're not mowing all the grass into the storm drains, into the open waters over. That's a huge part of it. It helps with our NPDES requirements, your impacts on your waters. So that's been a huge change. And of course, going back to natural systems and landscape practices to reduce and prevent erosion. And then of course, trying to use green friendly landscape in Florida and reduce the water and chemical usage. And many of our areas also we use reclaim, and we use that when Paul makes it available to us. One of the other things I also run all overseas is sanitation. Of course, we have a weekly recycling. Many people don't know this, but we're one of the highest percentage of recyclers in Pinellas County. We're at 43%, which is pretty good. For most municipalities in the county itself is in the mid-30s. We do about 2.5 tons pickup every time we do a pickup. And we have 4 recycling bins delivered to residents last year alone. So our residents just call up if they want more recycling. Of course, every year we do spring and fall, we do citywide cleanups for people getting rid of trash. That's very important. And we also work along with the county on our annual household electrical and chemical mobile collection, which I think has been very popular here in the city. And that participation has been very good. When we do our recycling, because it's through the contract or waste management, when the material goes out to the market, we do collect the money back. We get some back. Of course, unfortunately, the market now is not good, but we are still receiving some funds back. All those funds are used to purchase recycled materials, mostly in the parks. If you notice around, our picnic tables are recyclable, our garbage cans are recyclable, even some of our kiosks around town, we get all the information on the boards. We're using those funds to purchase those. So it's kind of a life cycle thing. One other thing I will do mention about sanitation in my yard waste facility. Of course, we have the yard waste facility. That's the green waste over off of 898 South Levis, where we bring all our green waste in. We separate it. And of course, we have a company out in the other side of Hillsborough County that takes the material and they turn it either into mulch or they bring it up to a burning facility and use it for energy. Along out there, we have a couple other dumpsters where residents can just drive over there and drop off garbage, tires, white metals, any type of debris that may have around the house. That way, don't have to worry about running it down to the county. So hopefully that's saving some people, and it's fairly inexpensive for the residents. One other thing I probably don't have mentioned here, well, I do have mentioned here, but yard recycling, we have 2 centers. We have yard waste recycling at 898 South Levis. We also have one over on Golf Road. The recycling center we have on Golf Levis is also going to be, the scale house itself is going to be relocated over to the yard waste facility when the Mears Boulevard comes through. The plan for that existing site is going to stay as a recycling center, and it's going to be manned. So I'm hoping actually to open that recycling center up to almost everything and maybe even possibly year round to all kinds of household chemicals and TVs and the like. So it'll be even more available to the residents and much more easy for them to anytime to bring the things over there, and they can take care of it. They can pick up trash cans there. They can pick up recycling bins. They can get all information. So kind of looking forward to that next phase. Well, I probably got through that pretty fast. It's a New Yorker talking, so we always talk fast. And I'm open to questions if you got questions.
Thank you for that presentation. There was a whole lot of information covered, so I'm sure
there's a lot there. Yes, I'm sorry.
No worries. So let's open it up. Does anybody on the committee have any questions that they would like to ask?
Yes, Dori, I have 2 questions for Mr. Funchin. Thanks. This is Karen Gallagher. Could you address the green streets and the plan for the green streets? And I'm just looking at Court Street and what they're doing. And can you address kind of how that fits into what you were talking about as far as the green streets? Like what type of activities are they doing with the permeable surface or the vegetation, et cetera, with that?
There's not a permeable surface going on that roadway. We have done some, there's really not really any stormwater section except for the natural flows we have there now. What we're looking to do with the county, and people don't know, probably don't realize, the end of Tarpon Avenue and Grand Boulevard there, where we come to the bayou, there's a stormwater system in there already. Believe it or not, that right away there is county. So we kind of share that stormwater system with the county. So we're looking at updating that system where Court Street itself does flow towards, and then probably improve the water system in there. Maybe some type of, it won't be a bioswale, but they have some type of cylinders or improved catch basins where we can collect all our materials, and then every once in a while clean it out. That roadway itself is getting some plantings. There'll be some planters along the roadway, some trees, some lighting. I don't have the plan right now in front of me. I apologize. There'll be some green spaces in there too. Yes.
Okay. And then my thank you. My other question is, as far as mosquito control, you know, things like that, and using non-natural ways to control mosquitoes. Have you guys discussed at all planting more natural plants or flowers or things like that that mitigate the mosquito population in the area versus, because I've had mosquito control come out and they're great as far as education. They are, they're fantastic. I have to say, I couldn't believe it. As far as education, you know, they walked around my yard and told me where, you know, I might be having an issue. They walked through my neighborhood, et cetera, and walked to each of my neighbors to educate. But as far as using any chemicals or things like that, especially if it's close to the water, have you guys discussed any like planting of, you know, citronella plants or anything like that? Has that ever come up?
I know that my new park supervisor has been talking with the county on those items over there, and I can probably get you a bit more of an update what she's dealing with. I know that on the stormwater side, and I'm sure they told you this, so one of the worst things for mosquitoes is standing in water. That's another reason why we are kind of aggressively, what we can, is the sweeping, just to get those puddles of water off the roadways. And, you know, there'll be some more stuff coming out on that, but, you know, educating the public on, you know, you got cans out in the yard or bird feeders and stuff, how you change the water over there. Simple stuff like that is very important. But yeah, we are in contact with the county and looking at some programs down the road. And I'll update you some information down the road from the Parks Department on where, how they're handling that. I just don't have it in front of me right now.
That's okay. Thanks so much. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Is there a place in the city where we could see pervious sidewalks or pervious streets, or is there a place in the county where these things are available to look at, to compare to impervious surfaces?
We haven't done anything here in the city as of yet. We are working with the our contractor for the concrete we purchased from. We're going to attempt to do a couple of sidewalks. Of course, when you put in impervious asphalt or concrete, the one you happen to use, you got to make sure you have a drain source. You just can't put it down without some place to run it to. One of the best places, actually, believe it or not, and I don't know how much you drive over in Hillsborough County, if you ever drive on the Veterans Expressway, that top layer coat is a pervious asphalt. You're driving down the roads right after it stops raining, the roadway is dry, but you look on the sides of your roads and watch the water run off. It does a number of things. One thing, gets, of course, the water off the road pretty quickly. And it controls the flow, so you don't have the puddling there, and you don't have the standing water on the parkway. It's pretty neat how, and it's been down there for, I think, about 5 years now. It's been very successful, very successful.
That's Veterans Highway?
Yeah, the Veterans Highway, 589.
That runs right by the airport.
Yes, sir. If you're out there when I drive around, just take a look. Right after, you'll be shocked how fast that water actually comes off the roadway. And that service has been on there almost 5 years now, so it's been, it's one of the first highways in the state of Florida to have it.
Is it a lot more expensive? Why isn't it being used more?
It's still in the testing stage because of cleaning it, because it has to be constantly clean. Yeah, you want to make sure it's clean, it's porous. So you have to worry about grit and stuff. So it's not going to work in every situation. If you're out by the beach, it's not going to work in the beach area over there because the sand that comes off the beach is in the erosion from there. So it's still kind of in the experimental stage. So they're going to wait till they get enough information before they can make it a little more available. But I have talked with Ajax, who does this over here quite a bit, and somewhere in the near future, we're going to hopefully be able to use some of that in a roadway and experiment here in the city. So,
you talk about the building envelope and about retrofits and new construction. When you speak of the building envelope, what constructs are you referring to?
all depends on exactly what building. And I'll take City Hall for an example. City Hall is a brick building, as we all know, with clay tile in the center of it. Over the time, that brick, as it wears down, weather gets to it, it becomes kind of porous. So rain and all hits it, it doesn't actually fall off the side of the building. It actually gets sucked inside the building. Then you have some mold and mildew and high humidity inside those buildings. So as we're improving that, we did that building a couple of years ago. We cleaned the brick, we fixed some of the joints, and then we put a sealer onto that, into that brick. So the water that goes on there just runs down the side into the landscape around the building. It cuts down the moisture inside the building. Cut down the moisture inside the building, it cuts down and helps you control your atmospheres and your workplaces and saves everybody all the way around. Also, your envelope will be your windows, will be your roofs, anything, your doors, everything over there is your building envelope. Everything that surrounds and keeps the elements outside the building is part of your building envelope. And of course, everything is different. We're doing siding over at the community center right now and all new windows. And of course, that siding, the old siding was just a vinyl with no backing onto it. And now we're pulling that off and we're putting a vapor barrier on that. New upgraded vinyl siding, all new storm radar windows and high U windows. Again, it's every time we do something, we're trying to improve that building envelope.
Do you shoot for a particular energy savings percentage with a given retrofit, or does it vary too much from building to building?
It varies too much from building to building. Age of the building, how much work you're actually doing, of course, your budget. As you know, the community center, we've been doing a lot of work over the years, but it's piece by piece. We have seen the differences. Probably the biggest differences in our building is that we have a building manager that manages all the air conditioning through a lot of the buildings in the city, City Hall, Public Safety. We can control the temperatures, the timing, the humidities. We can do a lot of stuff all right from either my phone or on my laptop at work. So when a building isn't being used, we raise the temperatures. When it's out, we lower it. When people are in, we lower the temperatures. We adjust it for the time the building opens up to the time it closes. That's probably been our biggest saver outside of LED lights in the city.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a question about the stormwater. How, you said that we're decreasing the amount of runoff going in through sweeping. Is there a rating system for that? And like, how do we know that what we're doing is successful?
Actually, it has to do with our NPDES permits, our National Pollutant Discharge Permits, with the state and the county we work with. And we actually have to record everything we pick up on the streets. We have to actually record that. We weigh it. It gets hauled off, and it's all part of our permitting. So you can see that it's public record. We're more than happy to give it to you. But of course, the more we pick up, the less goes out. A lot of the newer construction, what we're trying to do is minimize the amount of flow that's going all the way out to the open waters. A lot of swales, catch basins, bioswales. So anything that is picked up or we don't pick up by the sweeper gets caught in these areas, and then we can clean them out before anything gets out to open waters. And that's retrofitting existing stuff, and also all our new construction is that way now.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a question about the sidewalks too. Is there a certain width that's in the comp plan that they have to be? And is that like ADA compliant across the city? Is there a way to know how much of the city is compliant with sidewalks and with ADA?
No, I don't actually have the numbers on how far we are compliant. I know that I have to make anything I touch, it has to be coming in compliance. So any type of sidewalk project is gonna have that requirement in there. As far as the size of sidewalks, they can go from 4, sometimes 6 feet. I know that depending on the Artillery Road or feeder road, local road, anything that's Artillery Road, like I'll say Golf Road or something like that, has to be a minimum of 5 foot wide, and it has to be a minimum of a foot off the roadway. When you get closer to the roadway, they require a wider sidewalk. As far as the numbers go, I don't have the numbers, but I know that federal requirements starting in 2018, I believe, is any road I resurface or rebuild, anything it touches has to meet new ADA compliance, new standards. So everything we pave, everything we touch in the last couple of years and on to the future will be upgraded to existing ADA requirements.
Okay. Do you guys, does anybody else have questions? I have a few more, but I don't want to keep occupying time.
I just have a quick question. I just had a quick question regarding the recycling program, and I'm excited to hear that we are collecting so much, but yes. What is actually happening with a lot of the plastic at this point? I know that we were being told to continue to put it in our bins, but is it actually being thrown away, or what is happening with it since China doesn't take it anymore?
Actually, all that is being handled by our contractor Waste Management. Goes down to the yard down in St. Pete. They separate. They do try to put on the market what they can. They grind it. They bale it. There are some plastics that after, I don't have the exact codes on it, that can't be used. Unfortunately, most mm-hmm. of your bottle of water has been recycled so many times, you just can't use it. So that unfortunately ends up going down to the energy plant. It sits in
number ones and twos. How about yes. those?
I don't have that numbers in front of me, but I'd be more than happy to get better information back to tell you what's going and what's not going. I do have a recycling report I get from Waste Management every so often. I can show you actually the tons we collect and whatever money we receive back from those sales. That's all public record too.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, hey Tom. It's good to see you. Appreciate the presentation. Very informative. I always learn something new. And I've even made some notes of what other people have said because that brings other things to mind as well. I'm wondering, following up on what Denise was just speaking about, if we have on our sustainability website information about recycling and the numbers, which she just asked you, so that someone mm-hmm. could easily check to see what's recyclable that they have, and maybe even some figures about what happens to that. I love the idea of the recyclables going into the parks of yes. That for mm-hmm. furniture and so forth. I really like that. Appreciate that y'all are reducing the use of Roundup. I wonder if you have a scale that you're trying, benchmarks that you're trying mm-hmm. to reach, that you know by 2022 you want to be done with it, and meanwhile be ramping up on alternatives or thinking about other ways to ameliorate that insecticide mm-hmm. use, because I'm very concerned about Roundup. But it's as you know, it's especially okay. with our water table and so forth, it's really spooky to me, but that's just
with bees.
Just yes. a thought. Yeah. I'm also wondering about, I know we have the shared roads, and I don't recall seeing any signs. Maybe there are, just, and I know we're trying to reduce our sign pollution and being very mindful of what signs are where, but even around like Lemon Street where the streets are narrower, just something that reminds drivers that this is a shared roadway or bicycle shares the road or something like that, just so it's in their mind and might cut down on some agitation if a driver has to go extra slow because there's a bike there until the biker mm-hmm. can get off the road or whatever. Mm-hmm. I love the repair shop. That's very impressive. And it fits in with that reuse and recycle. Yeah. And I'm glad to see that y'all are embracing that. But My main question is, I know for Touch a Truck, we do the tree giveaways. And I'm wondering if as part of tying in, because the Sustainability Committee is looking for ways to engage more with residents and how we can let the residents know what we're doing and have more of a presence and kind of have that kind of a lens when they look at the city. I'm wondering if we could schedule on other days, like on Arbor Day or Earth Day or something, schedule throughout the year tree giveaways that can be picked up certain hours or, you know, one day of the week, just like when we have the special pickups of big trash, where people can go and get a native species and talk to someone in the parks department about where they should plant it, and so that our residents can actively participate in increasing our tree canopy. Sure. And I think that would be something, because one thing I hear after the Touch of Trucks is that people love it, but they say, I got there too late for the trees. You know, all the trees were gone by the time I got there. So, and that's happened to me as well. So I'd love to see more tree giveaways. And I think that would be a good use of our tree bank funds. And that's it. Appreciate you being with us and all the information and how you're participating in this as a city department.
Of course, it's nice hearing from you again. And we've had a lot of conversations, and I appreciate your thoughts and actually your commitment to the city. It's great to see. I'll touch on a couple of quick things. I won't take much time. I will talk to Shannon, our city arborist. She's phenomenal, as you know. She runs that program, A Touch of Truck, and see if we can expand it. I'm sure that Mark and all would be positive. Anytime there is issues with trees in the city, Shannon is open. She'll come out and help people with their plantings, their recommendations, and there's no charge to anybody. So, we need to use that. I know that my new girl I have working in the Parks Department will soon have her arborist certification too. So should be another source we can utilize. As far as the roundup goes, yeah, I don't have any numbers to tell you. We've cut back a lot. I think our purchases down probably about 20-25%. And it's all based on, I'll be honest with you, the labor I have. I mean, we're pulling a lot of weeds by hand. This is the busiest time of year. So sometimes the labor's a little tough. Sometimes you have weeds growing up where we don't want them. I'd rather have the weeds grow a little extra high than use that material if we can help it. But sometimes the public demand doesn't help either. You know, there's some people out there that are, I don't know if they're ignorant or just don't care. I don't know, but they give us a lot of grief sometimes when they see a weed. So we're trying to do our best to get it down. We are experimenting with a couple different type of chemicals, more natural, almost a citrus type. We've had some success, but not as much as we like. So hopefully we'll come up with there's some homemade solutions we can try too. We've experimented with that too. So hopefully one day. One of the other things we're doing though is changing what we're doing in some of our flower beds. We're going to start by using more of a ground cover, much like the perennial peanut, which is kind of a favorite of mine. Mm-hmm. It doesn't need it. We've done a lot of it on a trail. We're going to add some more on the trail, and we're going to start doing some other areas around the city in tree wells where we're using that type of material, whether it's the perennial peanut. Used to be a material up north. I think we start to come down here. It's called Pachysandra, a very glossy type of green covering. Easy to maintain, cut a couple times a year. It fights the weeds, chokes out the weeds, uses very little bit of water. It's great products. And the other quick one, I'll get out of the way because I'm probably taking up too much time. On the roads, we're trying to work more towards actually street markings instead of street signs. Putting the bicycle share on the road. Mm-hmm. As you can see, on many of the highways are starting to do that, even with the routes. So that's one of the areas we're going to start pushing towards, because I hate the signs as much as everybody else does. There's just too many. Just too many out there. They're kind of confusing after a while, and no one reads them half the time anyhow. So,
yeah, that's great. I love it when you can, like when they started doing the roadway markings, especially on highways, where you can see what lane you're in and when you have to get over, rather than having to look up and down. But in a city, that makes a lot of sense too. Appreciate it. Just an FYI, I recently started buying a natural product for weeds. And it's made right here in Florida. They have a guarantee, and you can get it actually in big drums. I can't think of the name right now, but I don't know if they partner with cities or not, but I can get that to you if you're looking to experiment with some of that. I'd be happy to share that name with you. And once again, appreciate it.
Any help I can get from anybody from the public, please forward on to us. We'll look at it. Yeah, without
that. All right. Awesome. Thanks.
You're welcome.
I have a few more questions. I have a question about the idle policy. I know that it's like super hot in the summer and very tempting to leave the air running. but I'm just wondering how the you said that there's a metric that you use, and then how often is that policy reviewed with staff?
We review all the time. We're working on our training of our drivers on how to cut back with the GPS, and we talk about the idling all the time. It's probably a constant theme on shutting vehicles down, especially one of our suppliers, Ford, that does not charge you by the mile on the warranties. They charge you by the hour, and that hour adds 24 miles to a vehicle. So there's a financial benefit too of shutting those, keeping the idle down to 5 minutes. The only ones that are exempt, of course, are the fire and the police, and you know why. We're constantly reminding all our people over here. It's constant about shutting these vehicles down when they're sitting there for more than a couple minutes.
Okay. When we were talking about recycling, I think that the most of the demographics were for residential. Can you talk about commercial recycling in the city?
We do some through waste management, but unfortunately the state doesn't require commercial residents to utilize recycling. They have, it's up to them. They can pick out who they want. They pick out their own vendors. Some of them do use waste management. I know that Publix shopping center, I think Walmart uses the waste management on the cardboard and all. But no, there's no way for me to, you know, we could probably write an ordinance over here. It won't be very popular, I guarantee you that. Yeah, we're kind of hands are kind of tied through the state on commercial recycling.
Oh. And then I had a question about materials that are used for, like, over at Discovery Park.
Yeah.
There used to be crushed shell where the, it's not like parking lot. It's, you know, where the cars are parked, but it's not parking lot. And now there's like a, I don't know, it's almost like crushed asphalt instead.
It may, over time, they might have been patched shell, which I love shell. After a while, sometimes it's hard to get. So in cases where we get a lot of washout, we will once in a while on the driving areas, not so much in the playgrounds, of course. We'll on occasion utilize it, but once we'll go back probably every year or so, and then probably freshen up areas that we had shell when the shell becomes available. So yeah, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about a playground before you go right into the gate of the playground, that area there.
Yeah, it's like crushed asphalt, and it smells gross, and it's like dirty. It's just gross. It's, so I would love to recommend that the city discontinue the use of that entirely.
Well, it has its purposes. It's crushed asphalt, and it comes off of roads and millings. It's a great product in areas where you have unimproved roadways. We use it for road base, put asphalt over top of it. Sometimes we use it for road for under the sidewalk. So it's a recyclable material and has a use. Unfortunately, my guys probably use it up there without thinking about it over here. And at times it can be a little smelly. It's never a perfect product, unfortunately. Depends on what road it comes off of, and I get in all those the tip of the aggregates and the apple materials that go into crushing roads. But it's a recyclable material, and it definitely has a value. Not in that situation, I'm sorry.
Like, not your children.
I got a note here to go back up there tomorrow and take a look and get a little more shell up there if it's available.
Well, and it's all washed out too, and it's completely covering the actual concrete part, so it's kind of a mess. But
well, guess what, I'll be putting a work order in tomorrow morning about 7:30. Okay.
Excellent, I appreciate that. And I think the other questions were all asked by other members of the committee already. So thank you so much for coming and speaking. Does anybody else have any other questions before?
I don't have another question, Dory, but I just have a comment. The use of glyphosate has been fairly strongly associated recently with development of Parkinsonism. So there is an additional reason to get rid of it for the safety of your people. As soon as possible.
I agree. And that's been brought to my attention by my employees themselves. So
excellent. Yeah. Good. Yep.
Yes.
I had the misfortune of treating a patient years ago, a farm worker who walked into one of the farm buildings one morning, a Sunday morning, and drank a bottle of an unknown liquid, turned out to be Roundup. He drank about 8 ounces.
Oh my God.
He said he was thirsty. Wow. He survived.
Well, thank God for that, yeah.
I don't know what happened to him subsequently, though.
Wow. Well, hope he's well.
So. Tom, I wanted to say thank you. Very, very good. All the questions you got, you have a lot of interest in what you're doing, so we appreciate what you do.
And if there's any more questions, my email's out there in the city. You can just shoot me an email, and we'll get any questions as quick as we can. So I can't hide from that, unfortunately. So. But I appreciate you thanking me for coming on, and I do enjoy what I do. I love the city here, and I hope you're here at least a few more years. So thank you.
Thank you so much for spending with us. Very much appreciated.
No problem. Take care.
All right. So the next item on the agenda is a discussion on follow-up items from our last presentations. Paul, can you give a little bit of an update? I had asked about timeline maybe for the comp plan, and how if we have some dates that we can put on the calendar so that we can plan to engage with that.
Yes, I spoke with the Planning and Zoning Director, Renee Vincent, who you all remember from last time, and she's already working on this process, and I wanted to give an overview of the process as I understand it from talking to her. The first step is forming a staff work group, which she's sent an email to all the directors asking them, you know, who would you like to be involved from staff? Tell me, you know, here's a, she sent a nice long Excel table of all the different sections of the code and anything else you think we should review. And then she's going to form a stakeholder group, and that would include you all as the sustainability committee, along with some other city advisory boards. And then there's going to be some visioning with the stakeholders on where we want to go. That'll turn into actual proposed revisions to the language in the code. That'll be reviewed and approved. And so that's the process sort of in big, big brush strokes there. Renee anticipated perhaps this winter, I think she was thinking that would be when she'd start getting into discussions with the stakeholders like yourselves. So I can't give you a month and a day yet, but sometime in that season, we're thinking towards the end of the year.
That is very helpful. Thank you. Were there any other issues that folks had follow up with? Well, that was a short agenda item. All right.
Well, Bob Robertson, Bob Robertson went over an awful lot of grants. He talked about a bunch, and he had a list of 50. I don't imagine there's been any change in any of them, but if there has, anybody heard anything?
I don't have any specifics. I do know that Bob updates his list of things and posts them. I know that's true with projects. I'm not sure about grants, but I will follow up and see if there's any updates and how he can share them with this group.
Thank you, Paul.
All right.
Any other discussion on that item? Okay, then let's move on to item number 4, which is the review of the updated community engagement items. And I'm going to share my screen here because I wanted to talk a little bit about meeting that we had with the Sea Grant folks and the Extension Agency folks on how we could work together. So I just wanted to give people a little bit more background about what Sea Grant is. So it's a partnership. It's a university-based program. So it supports research, education, and the extension agencies to conserve coastal resources and enhance economic opportunities for the people of Florida. So they're partnering with NOAA, the Education Board, the universities, and the Extension Office. And we had a great meeting with Thomas Rupert, who is with the Sea Grant College Program at the University of Florida, and Ramona Hector, who is with the Extension Agency in Pinellas County. So we had a Zoom meeting, Paul and Ashley and I, along with Thomas and Ramona, and we talked about how we can work together to each meet our needs. So the UF project, I've got it in blue here, can help Tarpon Springs with our sustainability committee by assisting in the initial outreach work to both provide educational resources and to also get some public input from multiple segments of the community. So with the work of Ramona and Thomas, primarily focused on underserved segments of our community, they have, Thomas actually is Spanish speaking, so we can have some real good communication with different segments of our population. We also talked about trying to pull in the business community and having them have a conversation with us about looking at priorities. And we also, during the meeting, kind of shifted our thinking from having the Extension Agency and the Sea Grant folks be the presenters and talking about flooding and sea level rise adaptation and the things that need to be done within the city, more to a train the trainer. So we would look for local champions and leaders within our community that we would help to identify. And then they would be the ones actually hosting the listening sessions and getting feedback from community members that way, so that we're really trying to get some authentic, you know, thoughts from community members and have that be a real, like I said, authentic and a good exchange of ideas. So we have a meeting coming up again on September 4th, where we're gonna give them kind of a list of folks that we think would be good local champions. So if you have some ideas for that, then please share those with Paul Smith via email. And I don't know, Paul, if you wanna talk about where we are with that process right now, or if it would be best just to leave it at that and say, if you have some ideas to send them to you.
Thank you, Dora. I'd like to take just a few minutes and show just the first idea of what we're thinking about for a list to get our committee thinking about how they can provide input on this list. So I'm going to share my screen here, and I've got a table, and I'd like to thank Robin Sanger for helping me get my first start on this table. I just thought naturally she would be someone I would go to first with her contacts and the work that she's done for Peace for Tarpon. So if everybody can see that okay, it's a spreadsheet, and I'll try to increase the size of it a little bit. So what we're thinking is a table of who the contact might be, that's the first column, what agency they're representing, and then what segment of the community might they be representing. And this is me just drafting up some ideas after talking with Robin Sanger on the phone. But here's some of the ideas that came to mind. We thought the Rotary for businesses, also the Chamber of Commerce for businesses, having contacts for the business community, the Union Academy area, naturally, Reverend Milton Smith, who formerly was with Mount Hermon. He's retired, I understand, and now he's serving as a chaplain for the fire department. So we have hopefully some good access to him to help us out. Also, Robin mentioned Ron Haddad and Pastor Kurt Snare of the Ministerial Alliance. I'm thinking they might be a community-wide resource, getting with the churches and various religious organizations in our community. Trevor Williams, he's with the Hospital Community Engagement. I understand he has former experience working at the Citizens Alliance for Progress. Robin herself, Peace for Tarpon, I think there's a lot of contacts there. David Archie with CAP. And also the Baha'i, Robin Sanger taught me a little bit about that. I'd never heard of this group, but apparently their whole mission is unity. Unity of communities, and similarly, the Unitarian Universalist Church. We also thought of perhaps the youth part of our community with the high school, also the academic with our local St. Pete College branch, and some community gardening. So I'm sure there's gaps, there's things that I didn't think of that. That's why I've got blanks here, and we can make a whole lot more blank rows depending on ideas. So that's 13 different potential champions that we could work with to get the word out and the word back in from the community. I'm going to stop the share there, turn it back over.
All right. Thank you for that. And thank you, Robin, for brainstorming and being the guru of who to go to community unite. So do we have any thoughts that anybody wants to expound on this particular item at this point?
I might mention the, I may be completely off base here, but maybe the Merchants Association, because they are businesses. So the president of the Merchants Association, or even reaching out to some of the other civic organizations like the Elks or the International Order of the Odd Fellows or things like that, because they are community involved as well. And if you need contact name for those, or if you think that's somebody that maybe we want to include, you know, add to that list, just let me know. But just trying to think outside of the box.
Thank you.
Yeah, I really think that getting the merchants involved might help quite a bit, because at this point, As we heard, recycling is just voluntary. You know, if they had more ownership in the process that we're going through right now as a community, they might do that, you know, volunteer to do that part willingly without having any state or city initiative mandated. So I think that's wonderful. I know that there's somebody at the library also who does coordinate education opportunities and community outreach. I can't remember her name right now, but she did put on an evening of sustainability several years back. And, you know, that there has to be somebody in that position that would be worth reaching out to.
I was thinking maybe it might already be covered in the Merchants Association or the Chamber of Commerce, but if there's some sort of organization with all of the people down at the Sponge Docks, all the different businesses, because they would probably have something to say and worry about maybe with the sea level rise and all that. Also, could we get a copy of the email from the UF Extension Office? That way I could kind of like look through that and see what you guys are planning in more detail. Ms. Larson?
Yeah, sure. Yep.
Awesome. Yes.
And I do have one person at SPC. There's an environmental club, and I did email her, but I'll send you her name as well so you can reach out to her.
Great.
As a follow-up to what was just said, I would recommend approaching Athena Sardoulias, who runs Tarpon Sponge. Second or third generation company on the Sponge Docks. She is well respected in that community of business people. I think she would be a good addition to the list. I would recommend also, if anybody knows who, and I don't, but somebody from the Orthodox Church, the Greek Orthodox Church, mm-hmm. would be in this community a strong person to have on such a list. Their spiritual leader is known as the Green Patriarch. And he, more than anyone else, is responsible for converting the current Pope to believing in the importance of climate change. So that could be a strong person, you know, somebody from the Greek Orthodox Church. I agree with Jean Hungaville. I think she'd be an excellent person to have. And I would also recommend Aaliyah Garrett, who is the secretary of Turn the Tide for Tarpon. So those, I would say those four people should be good additions to the list. I wish I could give you a specific name of the Orthodox Church. Athena might know who would be a good contact there.
Thank you. And were there any other, these are great, then I'll add them to the list. Anybody else?
Maybe someone from the League of Women Voters. Does that seem appropriate? I think that they sponsored an evening of the sustainability panel that took place at the Unitarian Universalist Church. Mm-hmm. So
David comes.
They'd be worth, yes. Yes. I can't remember his last name. You probably Hilden. Know. Yeah.
So one idea I had, and we can talk about this more, but sort of set up a telephone tree where people in the group identify which ones they know and could reach out to. And I think we could make that list of 20, probably up to 20 people now, more bite-sized if each of us had a few that we worked with directly. So let's think about that. Are there some other ideas on how to get everybody?
That's a good idea.
Can we do that now? Can you pull that list back up, Paul, so that we can just hammer that out?
Okay. Okay, so we got some handy numbers here, and we'll put all the new ideas down at the bottom. But for now, Anybody want to volunteer for Rotary?
I'll call Robin Weichel.
Okay.
You know, Paul, I'm thinking too, so that we all have the same message when we contact these people, if we could have a script of some sort that just outlines what our intention is or what it, so we'll have just a very easy way to share information consistently with everyone.
Okay, very good. I'll work with Dory on that and get that out in the next week. All right.
I'll talk to Milt Smith as well. Milton. Trevor Williams, I just met him. I'd be happy to talk to him.
Great. Yeah, maybe this is the easiest way to do it. So we'll start with one board committee member at a time. So Robin Sanger will talk to numbers one, number three. Any more numbers, Robin?
I'll talk to Ashetu, number nine.
Okay, 1, 3, and 9.
And I'll talk to Reverend Christina Spotty at the Unitarian Universalist Church. She's brand new and I want to meet her anyway, so that would be a good opportunity.
Good, so number 10, all right. Okay, well, that's certainly a good chunk there, Robin, 4 out of probably 18 or 20. 2, 3, 4, 5.
I know Ryan Farley, so I'd be glad to reach out to Ryan.
Okay, Denise.
And I think it would be really fun to speak with someone from the Tarpon High School. So Hannah.
Okay.
Number 11, Hannah Gatley. Do we have a contact for her at all?
We'll need to work on that. That was something that we, I don't know if anybody here knows Hannah, the teacher or a student, but we'll certainly help get that to you.
Okay, and I'll find out about the library outreach and education person.
Okay.
Well, I know it's not on the list yet, but I will get information on that.
Okay.
Sorry.
Paul, I'll take Jean Hungerville, number 2.
Good.
And the 4 people that I mentioned.
Great. I'm just making notes here. So number 2, and then also the, can you just repeat those again? The 4?
Yeah, a representative of the Orthodox Church.
Yep.
Athena Sardulius.
Okay.
Alia Garrett. Oh, and Jean was the 4th. So I need to pick one other person.
I think you're doing great. I think that'll be fine.
Okay.
Right. And I can do number 12, the SPC, and I'll reach out to that center and then the environmental club and see if there's anybody else who'd be interested.
Okay, number 12, very good.
Paul, are you there?
Yep.
Okay, this is Karen. I am happy to reach out to Ron Haddad and David Archie. If you have an interest in the Odd Fellows or the Elks, I know people there that I'm happy to reach out to. And as far as the high school, I don't know. I did a lot of work with the Interact Club over there. So, you know, I can always reach out to Lisa Fatalitas. I don't know who Hannah Gatley is though. But so Robin, I'm not gonna, I'll reach out to Robin Sanger too.
No, too easy, come on.
I look forward to it, Karen. Reach out.
Thanks, Robin. It'll give me an excuse to call you on the side. Yeah, so I won't take away from anybody at the high school, but I can't remember if it was Robin or Denise, I'm sorry. If one of you guys has difficulty with that, give me a call and I'll reach out to Lisa and work that way.
Yeah, we got to work through me, everybody. You can't be contacting each other on this.
Sorry.
That's all right. So, but we do have Kurt Snare, number 5.
I'll reach out to Pastor Snare.
Okay. And yes, please, on your other ideas with the Odd Fellows and the Elks, I don't think we can have too many groups helping us with this.
Okay. League of Women Voters, I would love to try to find somebody in that group to approach.
Yes, okay.
I have a contact, Denise, this woman named Beth Hovind, H-O-V-I-N-D. And I think she's like the community outreach person for the area, but the library, I believe, knows of her. She's spoken with them.
Okay.
So, boy, we made short work of that. Let's see if there's anything left. Does anyone see this is like a numbers game? So far, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. Don't see a 6. Okay, nobody mentioned number 6 at the hospital. Does anyone work with the hospital? Or
yeah, no? I mentioned that. I just met him, and I will reach out to him.
Wow, Robin. Okay, yeah. You're up to the...
I think I have five on my list. So it'd be Robin Weichel, Trevor Williams, Milt Smith, Ishetu, and Christina Spotty is who I have.
Okay, so number 7. 7's Robin. Robin can talk to herself.
I can talk. I do it all the time.
Okay.
Right. Is that allowed under the Sunshine Law?
I think so.
Okay.
Unless I'm a bad influence on myself.
Yeah. I think we got it. Yeah. Yes, I think that's all the numbers. So thank you, everybody. And so I will follow up sending this list along with suggested talking points to you. And I'll probably need about a week to get that to you. But I think this is a real strong start. And we can keep this going as an agenda item as we're working through it. I'll turn it back over to you and stop sharing now. Okay, story.
Okay, so we've talked about the C grant. We need to talk about the flyer. So do you want, I'll just hand it back over to you, Paul, to talk about that.
Sure. I'm gonna do another share screen with the flyer now. So find that. So Karen helped me with some markups and I wanted to share that with the group. Karen, I think had some great ideas in the beginning and she's offered some more thoughts. Those are the red font there. So the black font is what was originally in the second draft that you all received a few weeks ago. And the red markup is the most recent edits that Karen thought to add once she's reviewed this draft. So I thought this would be a good place to start. Hopefully everyone's had a chance to see that already, but mm-hmm. I'll open it up to comments here.
I would make some minor changes in sentence structure. The only substantive thing I would recommend changing would be the second "do you know," TS as 46 miles of shoreline, et cetera, to just above, please learn more. And I'm referring to the first "did you know" flyer, but I would convert the first paragraph to 3 sentences. I would break up the second sentence to after planning, I would put a period and then begin a new sentence. It suggests actions that maintain our quality of life, protect our environment, and sustain prosperity for future generations. The next sentence is from the previous flyer. I would change it to not "we are preparing to develop," but "we are writing a sustainability action plan to address areas of importance to our city." Community as a word appears perhaps too many times. Then I would say, join us. We need input from you to make the plan better. And I would put "you" in caps. Then I would say, we are involving residents in several ways, including articles in local newspapers, surveys in, I'd substitute city for community and virtual meetings. And then I would put, did you know Tarpon Springs has 46 miles of shoreline? Did you know Tarpon Springs represents, did you know? And then say, please learn more, et cetera. So just basically just some minor changes in sentence structure, but I would put the data like 46 miles of shoreline just above, please learn more. I think that flows a little better. Basically no change in content.
Okay, did you speak to the, I lost one sentence you were talking about right after you said, join us, we need input from you, all caps, to make the plan better. Then what did you have after that?
We are involving the residents in several ways, including.
Okay.
Rather than planning outreach, we are involving.
Whether you want it or not.
We need you.
Okay, and then is that where you list the sub-bullets?
And then after that is surveys and suggestion boxes, city instead of community, then virtual meetings, and then did you know?
Okay.
So that immediately after you get this data in your hand, did you know, then you see where you can go to learn more about it.
Okay. I think I've got pretty much all of that. Anybody else have some thoughts?
I like what Paul suggested, and I like, you know, just announcing that we are writing the sustainability action plan. So as he kind of pared the sentences down a bit and was more direct, I agree with that approach. I think that would have a lot of punch, but also be a really good invitation to get people involved.
Good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like the changes too. I think it flows better. And I have a little 10 second delay, but just going back for a moment, do you mind if I go back to our prior list that we had there? Just for one sentence of all the folks. You know, since I'm on this committee, it just occurred to me it might be awkward for me to be on that list, but Peace for Tarpon, we have a lot of other folks that I'm sure would be happy to engage. So if I'm happy to engage, I just don't want to compromise the integrity of this committee, or to, you know, just putting that out there, it might be a better fit for someone else to do it. But if it's a good fit for me to do it, I'm happy to do it. Okay, now we can come back to the present time.
I don't have any concerns with you working with Peace for Tarpon on that. Does anybody else?
No.
Seems like a natural fit.
All right. Very good.
So on the flyer, any other comments? I think I got a lot of good input here. What I propose to do is I will send Dr. Robinson first my understanding of the edits, and that will give him an opportunity to straighten me out if I miss something. Mm-hmm. And then once I get that squared away, I'll send it out to everybody. How's that sound?
Sounds good.
Sounds good.
All right. Very good.
And can I ask a question? Because we talked about maybe putting this in as a mailer, but then perhaps also doing some kind of postcard or something. Do you want to talk about that? Or my only concern is if we try to do a postcard, I don't think all this text is going to fit.
Yes. Yeah. To share with the group, I'd had a discussion with planning and zoning, and they use postcard mailers sometimes for getting information out. And I did see it as having some advantages versus the utility bill. We all get a utility bill, well, most of us probably, and you open that envelope and you're looking for your bill and there's this piece of paper in the way, and a lot of people, it's just a nuisance and they throw it away and don't read it. Whereas a postcard might have a better chance of surviving that first wave of clearing the junk. So that's the idea of why we thought to put that out there. I have no idea what the cost is. I do have a good idea of the utility bill mailer. I don't really see a risk of doing utility bill mailer. It was just another idea.
My thought is the reverse of that. I'm more inclined to throw away random postcards and things that are in the mail, especially this year with all the political stuff that I'm getting. But you have to open your utility bill.
Right.
You know, okay. I mean, that's my thought. And I always look at what's in there. I don't know about anybody else, but I'm always interested in what's on the agenda in there. But I guess
have another suggestion.
Individual style. Mm-hmm.
Ashley, did you have something?
Sorry, I thought that Denise was still talking. Sorry about that. Yeah, so I did have another suggestion. I just wanted to let you guys know that I briefly reached out to Karen Lemons. She's the economic development manager here at City of Tarpon Springs. And I'm wishing now I would have sent you guys this link. But she has a monthly e-newsletter that she sends out at the end of each month. And she was very willing to let us submit something to it. I can definitely get this link out to you guys so you guys can take a look, but at a glance on the page, she had like local businesses, some highlighted businesses, she had like a census survey link, and I know that this is also shared on the city's Facebook page, and she said she has about 900 subscribers, so I don't know if those are all specific to businesses or if there's also residents, but I can clarify that and get back to you guys about that as well, but I just want to put that out there as an option.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Ashley. I think that's a great opportunity to engage that, you know, subset of, and if it's businesses, then it's that subset. But if it's the whole community, that's even better because we're reaching more folks. So I think that that's a fantastic opportunity. And thanks to Karen Lemons for that offer. All right. Any other discussion about the flyer?
I would say
Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think we're reaching a point where we'll have something ready for that next meeting and talk about the details of getting it out. That would be the goal. Go ahead, Taylor.
Hopefully, yeah, we can get it out soon. But I feel like we could definitely, for like a postcard, we could probably condense this down to just kind of like the ADD, did you know, and a few more lines. I feel like we could make that fit onto a postcard as well as like the other media.
I can follow up. If it's not a real high cost thing, yeah, I don't see a downside to sending a different version than a postcard. And so I will make note of that and let you all know what I find out.
That would be, it could be a great idea once we do have the date set for the meetings that we're trying to coordinate with IFAS and Sea Grant folks, that may be good to put the little postcard out. We could do some, do you know, and hey, these are the dates and times for these upcoming meetings so that it's a little more concrete for them to get involved.
It wouldn't have to be an either type of decision. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. The other thing that we had maybe discussed on the last call was perhaps doing some kind of questionnaire and having it on the city's website. So I don't know. I kind of just was trying to have a brief like explanation of what the information is that we're trying to gather and why we're trying to gather it, and then have some questions about what do you value in terms of, you know, working on these different ideas, maybe even leaving it just open-ended. And then it would be a way if we use Google Forms to just be able to generate responses very quickly. It allows you to just see the data So somebody wouldn't have to compile it. It allows you to put it right into a spreadsheet. So that's something that I think might be good to discuss, like the kind of questions that we think would, I mean, I think it might be good to have some that are specific or check all that apply, but then also just some open-ended, like, what are your thoughts? What are your concerns? What's your biggest concern in Tarpon, and see if we could get some feedback that way. So I wanted to throw that out to the group and see what your thoughts are about that.
Dory, the Board of Commissioners just voted unanimously to re-adopt the Pinellas County mitigation plan. And as part of that, rather lengthy, I think it's 1,200 pages, there's a mitigation strategy survey in there, which is pretty good. It's a little lengthy, but I can scan it and send it to Irene and Paul, and they can share it with the rest of us if you're interested.
Mm-hmm. What types of questions is it specific to? Do you know?
Okay, just what defines your role in the community? Please rate each of the following hazards on a scale of 1 to 3, flooding, thunderstorms, winds, hurricane, wildfire, sinkhole, extreme heat, da-da-da-da-da. Please list any additional hazards. If you're a homeowner, do you have adequate homeowner's insurance? Do you carry flood insurance? Do you know that most standard homeowner's insurance policies do not cover rising water? So it's pretty thorough. If you are a homeowner and a disaster substantially damaged your home, which of the following option would be the most likely thing you would pursue? Rebuild, sell, not sure, not applicable. So it's really an attempt to educate as well as get information. Fairly thorough, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that would be good to see what that looks like. And then maybe bring it back to the group too to see what kind of information we're looking to get. I think that's, you know, part of what the focus groups are going to be, or the community information, like that's, but it's just one more place to try to get data points to see what's on people's minds and what they, you know, are concerned about and want to see work being done.
Dory, I have one more update to give that might be right along those lines that I think is really exciting. If I can just take a few minutes.
Yeah, please.
So several of our city departments are working on, there's been an RFI submitted through the procurement department, a request for information from the industry, basically. And what we're looking at, I think I'm gonna be on the staff committee, is an online community engagement platform. I'll say it again, online community engagement platform. And I'll just read you a few notes from the RFI document. The city is seeking an online community engagement platform in order to better inform the public about emerging plans and projects, obtain public input that is both quantitative and qualitative, and to respond to the ongoing COVID crisis, which restricts in-person community engagement. So I saw this and I thought of us and what we're trying to do, and I think this could really be a tool that we could use. You know, Renee is heading this up with her recent county experience. We've talked about that before, how that's gonna really, I think, help us in our efforts, use of technology and that sort of thing. But I guess the tools will include online surveying, data analytics, which is what Dory was referring to, transparent platform to share comments and engage, the ability to receive input anonymously, ease of use to the end users, and mapping and graphics capabilities. It goes on and on, but it sounds like this is something, you know, we're still in the exploratory mode, but if this is a tool that we can get selected and approved, this might be a real a tool for us as a sustainability committee.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a timeline of when, if right now you're just getting information, like when there would be a bid process and then when that would be accepted and when the city would actually have the product?
I don't yet, but I can sense that this is moving pretty quickly. I think several departments need this for their business, doing their business. So, you know, I think in a matter of months, we could get to at least a recommendation. for a ward, and then it would be up to the city manager and commission to see if it's something, depending on the cost, if it's something we can sustain. But my preliminary feedback is the costs aren't terrible. It's like 10 to 15,000 a year. And I think if that's the case, and this tool is used in many departments like planning and zoning, et cetera, it could really be a feasible thing.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, let's keep us posted on that. And I think either way, we should probably be, as a group exploring the kind of questions that we want to be asking the community.
Yes, parallel paths. I'm not suggesting we wait on something, but I'm just saying there might be some more things coming down the road for us.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. So I guess then if we could be thinking about the types of questions that we want to be probing the community on, I think that would be good to revisit next month for a conversation. And then we'll have had that call with the extension folks and get a clearer understanding of what those information sessions and information gathering sessions will look like. So just wanna always be thinking of ways that we can be working ahead so that we're ready, we're ready to pounce when the opportunity presents itself.
And on that note, Dory, since we're still under item four, the community engagement, may I suggest to the committee that this talking point to reach out to your stakeholders would be, or your champions rather, would be an introductory type of conversation where we're saying, we want to lean on you to help us. This is the general area that we're working. We'll have more information for you, as we develop it. Does that sound like where we're heading as a first step? For now?
Were you going to kind of write something, a little bit of a guideline or introduction?
Yes. What I'm suggesting is that you sort of bring this champion up to speed on what we're doing and what we're going to be asking, but we stop short of telling them to do it yet until we know what exactly we want them, to ask, right? Right. And I think by next meeting, we should be in a better position to do that.
So I think that we need to tighten up kind of our ask and our, I think we should not assume that they would inherently know what we're talking about with any of this. So a good explanation of what sustainability is, what resilience is, all of those things that we explained to the commission, like why we're doing this, the importance of it. And then, asking them to help facilitate these conversations in the community. But I definitely think that I would like it to be consistent what we're communicating out as a group. So if you have any suggestions, Paul and I will work on that this week. If you have anything within the next couple of days, please get it to him so that we can incorporate that into what we put together as a document to give to you to have, to feel comfortable that we're all explaining it the same way and using the same the same words. Does that sound good to everybody?
Yeah.
Sounds good.
I was just a little aside, I was on a call and I wish that I could share the information, but it's proprietary, but it was a marketing guy who's been in the business for years and years and has started working on climate change and how to the language and the different just ways to get the idea across. And he just emphasized over and over that you can't assume that people know what you're talking about, because there's only about 7% of the population is really dialed into this issue. So if it gives you some scope, that blew me away, but I live and breathe and eat, for professionally, and it's my passion, these types of issues. But in terms of the majority of the population, they just don't, everybody's busy leading their lives, and it's just not, people are just not as knowledgeable as we might think that they are because we're so engrossed in it. So that was a big takeaway for me, was just to make sure that, being very clear and making sure that they aren't making assumptions of what people already have an understanding of. So, okay. Well, then, any other thoughts on item number four?
I did have a quick comment. I think it's really important to ask some sort of open-ended question, like what topic or what issue is important to you? And I think you said you had some sort of analytic. I've seen some that, like, basically if people put in, you know, a bunch of keywords, like they'll put, sea level rise, biodiversity, and then it kind of tallies that all up. I think you mentioned that you know of something that does that, but I think that's just like an important question to ask for sure.
Thank you, Taylor. Yep, I think there is definite value in open-ended. Agreed. Okay, then let's move on to item number five. So items for the next agenda. I think we have one more Paul Smith presentation from city staff, or there may be more, but I think we initially had three. So we had planning and then public works and then building development, Kevin Powell presenting. Is that still the plan?
That's the plan, yeah. And the topics he'll be talking about are flood protection, the community rating system, building permitting requirements, and perhaps the city arborist. The city arborist works under that department now.
That would be great. I would love to hear from the city arborist and to hear what, because I like think you said that he was working on a master plan for the city, right? Something like that. Would love to hear that if we can make that happen. All right, so we have that presentation, and then I guess we would have, if we have any follow-up questions for Mr. Funchin from tonight, if anybody has anything that they send to Paul and can get to him, or if he was gonna also, I think, look up a few things and if we could get some of that information back for next month. And then, I think another conversation about the community engagement. So an update about the outcome of the meeting that's coming up on September 4th with IFAS and with the Sea Grant folks.
And a final flyer.
And then a final flyer, yes. Mm-hmm. And then maybe you'll have a little more information about that, the RFI, where if the city's made any progress on that, because if you said you think it's gonna move quickly, then that might be good to get an update on that.
Okay.
Does anybody else want to add anything to next month's agenda other than those items?
Is somebody going to be getting a copy of the Pinellas mitigation plan that Paul mentioned? So that we can read it and see what some of the questions were in it? Can that happen before the next meeting so that we can look at the questions that are on that?
Yeah, yeah. My understanding is that Dr. Robinson's going to send it to Paul Smith and then Paul will send it out to us.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, that's my understanding too.
Okay, well then I think we've got our agenda set for next month. Let's go to the next item then, which is public comments. Is there anyone in the public that's in the meeting tonight that would like to speak?
If anyone would like to speak, please raise your hand and you'll be allowed in. And at this time, we do not have any raised hands.
All right, I would like to acknowledge an email that was received and that Paul distributed. It was received by Paul and then he distributed it out to us from David Keyes. And he, I just wanted to thank him for the email and for all of the resources that he sent to us. It's quite a list of sustainability resources, and the one that I thought was interesting, talking about how we have to be precise, and being vague with sustainability can be a hang up. So I'm really interested in digging into that. And I have already started reading the American Planning Association's Assessing Sustainability, a Guide for Local Governments. So if you are listening, Mr. Keyes, thank you very much for those resources. And I know that I will be looking into those. And I'm still continuing to read our drawdown book and trying to glean some information from that. So I just wanted to acknowledge that that public email that came in.
Thank you.
I would just like to add, Dory, to that, that I bought the book from World Watch Institute, Can a City Be Sustainable? Got it from Amazon, and I've read it. It's
already?
Yeah,
it's only on the 17th.
Well, it's only 350 pages, so it's not a big deal. But it's a nice book. Some of it's a little out of date, but it kind of bounces from cities that have instituted their own plans, like and Denise will like this, Portland, Oregon, Vancouver, Canada, Barcelona, Spain, Freiburg, Germany, and then some huge places that would not be relevant to us. And then Melbourne, Australia, which is 120,000 population. But each of these cities, I think, has something that would be useful for us to discuss. Probably starting with Portland, although that's on page 290. But and then alternating between the cities are concepts, building concepts, et cetera. So it's an interesting book, and it's quite easy, quite readable. Mm-hmm. And again, I think we owe a debt of gratitude to Dr. Keyes for sharing this information with us.
Yeah, thank you guys. This is, I really was impressed by the links that he included as well. I didn't read the book or order it from Amazon, but it's great to hear a report back about it. And a couple of things come to mind, but we're not at committee comments yet. So shall I go ahead or shall I wait? I'll just go.
Go ahead.
So if we have, as we get these, for example, Peace for Tarpon works with our library, and we have a Peace for Tarpon section in our library. So, and a bibliography of all things that are available in the library. And I think that would be a good option for this committee as well. So as we get these resources to us and someone vets them, as Paul has done, and said, this is a goodie, then, you know, the city can buy them, or maybe Carrie Rupp-Calvis has it in her budget or whatever, but we can start to have on our website the resources that are available at our library and start building that up. And especially now, I think that it'd be cool for folks to be able to go to the library and get, you know, get access to some of these. But what I was wondering about Mr. Keyes was, it sounded like he included his phone number. So I thought, I wonder if he wants someone to call him. So I almost called him, but then I thought, well, maybe that should be the chair calls him, or maybe Paul should call him, and to see, are you a snowbird? Do you live here part-time? Do you want to be a community champion for a little bit? Are you, you know, yeah, he obviously knows some of this. And it's like, if someone is reaching out, at least to have a warm handoff and say, we like what you said, Dory, was lovely. Just but say that to him in person, or someone respond as a, you know, we have to, I think, be connecting like that. So that was a thought that I had about that.
Yeah, I would be happy to give him a call and reach out.
Great, thanks.
All right, do we have next on our agenda some staff comments? I know we do.
I do. So the first thing I wanted to do is update you guys, because I did have a question last time on the Friends of the Library grant, and how those funds are typically it's distributed. So the Friends of the Library donations are ongoing, and they're a varying amount each year, but there's no official application process. So that I spoke to Carrie about. She's the library director. So if you have any other questions about that, I can follow up with her a little bit further. And then I also wanted to talk to you guys about ICLEI and just kind of update you where we are. So I'm currently working with Paul to kind of finalize and distribute the templates that ICLEI had sent us to request data from different divisions and departments within the city. The first one we're going to send out it to is public services. So we have a couple different docs that we're going to send out. One of them is going to be for water and wastewater. So it includes like potable water, and it's questing things like volume of total water supply delivered in 2019. It talks about for wastewater, it's total population served and total volume of water treated in 2019. So it's questions like that, and then it gets even deeper. But then we're also going to be including templates on off-road vehicles. So that's going to be like your lawnmowers, gas and electric powered tools, chainsaws, small tools, large utility tools. And then we also have the contractor vehicles that we're going to be sending out. That's going to go towards vendors that we use for like golf course ground maintenance. And then like Tom had mentioned, we use waste management. So it would go to them as well. And it's going to be things like fuel type, vehicle type, miles. And so that way we'll get a good source of data from all avenues. So that's where we are with that right now.
Thank you, Ashley. And what we're talking about is feeding the model. You know, we've got a model, that a tool that we can use through this organization. And the first step is to bank those data requests to our departments so that we can start putting this information in. So we look forward to, as we start getting results, and there's a lot of good growth you all to let you know how we're doing as we go with our baseline efforts. But Ashley's been heading that up, and we appreciate the work she's doing.
Thank you, Ashley. Thank you. Paul, do you have some other comments?
I do, but I was going to ask Irene. I think she wanted to give an update.
Wonderful.
Yes, that's correct. I just, as you're aware, when the sustainability committee started, the board had staggering terms, and then thereafter the terms would be 3 years. So it's that time, and Mrs. Gallagher had a one-year term that would be expiring at the end of September. I did speak with her, and she is eligible to be reappointed for, you know, another 3 years. And also we have another position to fill, which is Ms. Nelson's position, who was the alternate. The reason we haven't filled that, because we knew it was coming up due to be expired in the end of September as well. And we didn't want to go ahead and appoint for that short period of time. So we do have that spot open as well. And if you know of anybody, we don't have any applications on file for the sustainability committee. But if you know of anyone, please have them reach out to me, or they can go online and get an application. We're looking at bringing that back to the BOC for appointment and reappointment on the second meeting of September, which would be the 22nd of September. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. And Karen, thanks for agreeing to serve again. If you are selected, sure. It's been sure. Great having you on the board. Fantastic contributing member. Appreciate you.
Thank you.
All right. Are those all of the staff comments then? Paul, did you want to say anything else?
I think that's it for now.
All right. All right, then I'll open up to committee comments. Who would like to share?
A topic that I think we should at some point discuss and should definitely keep on our radar. There was a special meeting of the Board of Commissioners the 4th of this month, and a topic that had been postponed at least twice finally came up, and that was can you still hear me?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, because I've lost my video, but if you can hear me, that's all that matters. A proposal for a walkway along the eastern shore of Whitcomb Bayou. Portions of the green space there between South Spring Boulevard and Whitcomb Bayou are lined with riprap, which is granite boulders, say 2 feet in diameter, 1 foot in diameter, give or take. This there, and Bob Robertson presented six different suggestions on how to build a walkway on top of the riprap, on top of the green space. And the BOC discussed the six. Vice Mayor Carr had a preference for, well, it doesn't matter because I can't show you pictures of it, but a walkway without guardrails that would be slightly below the top level of the riprap. Whatever ultimately happens with this walkway probably belongs on our radar and probably is a topic for future discussion, because the riprap is not impervious to water, and this would be whatever ultimately is put in place in the 1500 feet, give or take, between the boat launch at the south end of Craig Park and the Little Hump Bridge at the corner there with Martin Luther King Drive, will probably become the model for an extension of walkway berm around the south end of Whitcomb Bayou and perhaps onto the beaches, perhaps Sunset Park. It would be missing a golden opportunity, my opinion, if whatever is put in place did not raise the berm and prevent flooding in the future with sea level rise. So I'm just throwing that out. The final result of the discussion was that Commissioner Vaticiotis was appointed liaison between the board and the Army Corps of Engineers and was directed to discuss with the Corps what they recommend be done in terms of construct. He is to work with city staff to pull that off. But I just wanted to bring this up as something that we might want to weigh in on as giving our opinion to the Board of Commissioners.
I think that's a really good suggestion, Paul. It also begs the question of when things like this come up, as a committee, how can we effectively engage in a positive way with the BOC? And, you know, eventually, hopefully they'll say, someone on the board will say, well, what does the sustainability committee think about this? Or what are their suggestions? And we'll be seen to as that natural body to come to see what our thoughts are. But until then, I think keeping the door open in a way that we have positive suggestions and can send them along or say that this is a topic that came up. And I would look for, you know, Paul, for your suggestions about that and to see how we can start building that relationship. Since we are an advisory board, when these items come up, how we can actively participate and be that advisory board that we're tasked to be.
Yes, I'd be happy to carry along that message. In fact, I think I'm going to be in that working group with Commissioner Vaticiotis. So I'd be happy to talk about those concerns. And I think those are good concerns. It's a lot more than aesthetics involved here. We don't want to interfere with the function of that as a barrier to flooding.
So I guess just next steps with this, I think that it might be good to, like when we heard from Sarasota, how they've got some natural barriers. Is there, I mean, I'm sure if he's consulting with the Army Corps, then they, but I don't want to assume that they have seen things like that. So that may be a way that we can just say, hey, did you know that this, you know, exists, and maybe a something to consider as part of the solution.
There we go.
I'm certainly not an engineer. I don't know that I would feel comfortable, you know, weighing in on what would functionally work, but I do think that our board could certainly serve as a resource to at least exchange information. Hey, we've seen this, you know, just something to consider.
Just in private conversations with, you know, members of the board, they have expressed that they would like to hear from us, you know, on the day-to-day stuff that they deal with, if it's appropriate. That's just informal, but I kind of get the feeling that they wouldn't mind hearing from us on topics like this. In fact, I think they would welcome it.
So then I guess the question is, how do we do that in a timely way that they've got their issue that we find out about on our meeting and then have a month before we can send resources? And then, you know, I like this idea, but we certainly need to like talk through how it works, you know? Other than, you know, individually, we know what resources there are and can be individually sharing resources. But I do think that that's something that would be worth and would certainly warrant further discussion. Like, how do we engage the commission?
How do we formalize a process where we are involved and we're asked to take a look at an issue like this. Mm-hmm. It was on the cover. It was a cover story on the paper, in the paper, local paper recently. And I was thinking as I was looking at it, surely there has to be a very sustainable way of dealing with a situation like this, but had no time to investigate. I guess it has been a topic that they've been discussing for quite some time, but I was not aware until I read about it in the paper.
So what I'm coming to just kind of on the spot is that we serve at the leisure of the Board of Commissioners. So I think that we would need to have a request from them for us to weigh in on a particular issue that they deem big or consequential enough that it would be beneficial. And if we, I don't know if Paul, if Smith, if that could be communicated to the Board of Commissioners, that we would, you know, I guess we would need to see if we all are in agreement with wanting to try to weigh in on certain issues. But I think that would be the solution, is to, you know, if we have some sort of request from them to weigh in, then that would be appropriate.
Mm-hmm. Well, that would definitely guarantee solicited input versus unsolicited input.
Yeah.
I do like that idea. I am concerned. I've been saying this all along, that we've got a pretty big plate of things to work on. And if we start focusing on projects, these will take up agenda discussions, probably multiple agendas. So certainly I agree that Dory's point, that if it's something the board is looking for you to advise them on, then by all means, we'd want to put it on an agenda and discuss it and then report back to the board. So I can certainly explore that for you all and give you an update next time.
Well, and Paul, it could be at the very least that we are looking at this, that we're not, you know, I'm not an engineer either. I have no idea, but that we are concerned with sea level rise, and that's right at the bayou. But the fact that we had a conversation about it so that they know that we're looking at what's happening in the city, not to problem solve or supersede the Army Corps or their, you know, whatever their priorities are, but to just let them know that it was a topic of discussion and we're interested, and that we like to engage. We would like to engage at their, what works for them to, you know, to engage in.
Okay.
Any other committee comments? Very briefly, before we go, we have 4 minutes. I just wanted to say that I have spoken with Dunedin's sustainability coordinator, Natalie Gass, and they are working on their new city hall. And so they're going to be installing charging stations for electric vehicles. That's what we were talking about. And then we also, of course, were talking about just what else is going on. And they're in the process of looking at their sustainability action plan and writing one as well. And they are also doing it by committee in-house. So it was nice to hear that we've got a cohort city going through the same experience. And she offered to, I mean, I know that she and some of the other sustainability directors and Paul are already working as a cohort together, but it was nice to, you know, she said, well, you know, if we can be of help to you and, you know, we can be of help to you. So just sharing that, you know, we're going through these together. And so we should definitely be leaning on each other for what's working and what's not. And it was just nice to hear that they're working on theirs as well. So.
How far in the process are they?
They are going by committee. So they've got different work groups within the city that are tackling each of the topics. And I don't know that they've gotten any community feedback yet either. So
I think Ashley and I will make it a point to go down and visit and bring back any information we can that would be helpful to us. But I got a feeling we shouldn't sell ourselves short. I think we could help them too. But
no, that's what I said, if we could help them too. I'm just farming you out, Paul. Guess what? Dunedin needs your help. You've got enough to do. I wouldn't do that to you. But no. All right, well, if there isn't anything else, then I guess bid you all adieu. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn tonight's meeting.
I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right, y'all have a wonderful month, and we'll be in touch. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.